I ended up at Marshall Space Flight Center at NASA. We were looking at nuclear rockets. Now, this time, I was not particularly excited about nuclear. In this buddy of mine's office, he got a book on his shelf, and the book was called Fluid Fuel Reactors. And it seemed really different than the kind of nuclear energy we had now. And they also mentioned in this book a lot about thorium, 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 thorium. Two spots away from uranium, that's about all I knew. I was like, dude, what the heck is thorium?
This is Kirk Sorensen.
Good to meet you.
Hey, man, how you doing?
2011 was when I first met Kirk in person.
The crew got to the plane a little late.
We're not going to make 3:30.
It looks like I've got a full schedule.
Hey, Lisa, I can't really talk now.
Opinion question, what are you
now? I'm busy now.
Mount Royal University.
I do apologize for being late.
And Calgary Protospace.
We shouldn't be parking here, but whatever.
We're booked back to back.
If they tow your car, am I going to lose my luggage?
And the next day, he'd be speaking at TEDxYYC. Why the mad rush? For 2 years, I'd been wanting to bounce Kirk's message off a wider audience.
Our policy is very simple to understand, no nuclear. Is there more nuance demanded there? Concerns about nuclear energy can be addressed with future technologies.
To help me determine if thorium was really a viable energy solution.
Let me tell you how this stuff was discovered. There was a guy named Glenn Seaborg who worked at Berkeley Labs in 1942. This was a guy who had discovered plutonium. He thought, I wonder if we could hit thorium with a neutron and turn it into something. Again, fission had been discovered like 3 years earlier, so they were still in the very beginnings. So he got this grad student, you know. Everybody's been a grad student knows what it's like when a professor says, all right, I want you to go into the nuclear lab and turn on the neutron bombardment system and expose this sample and find out what happens. Yep, I've done it, sir. I have made something new. Thorium did absorb the neutron. It became uranium-233. Isn't that cool? Seaborg said, yes, absolutely. Okay, now let's take the next step. Poor little grad student. Hit it with a neutron and see if it will fission, because I think it'll fission. I think it'll fission just like uranium-235. Okay, yes, sir. Goes off, does the experiment, comes back and says, yep, you were right. It did fission. You're correct. It's a new form of nuclear fuel. Then Seaborg popped the really, really, really important question. He said, now I want you to go figure out how many neutrons came off when it fissioned. Because if that number is below 2, we really don't have a story here. Sir, the number is 2.5. Seaborg looks at his grad student. This is December 1942, and he said, you've just made a $50 quadrillion discovery. Seaborg was absolutely right. He had figured out that thorium could serve as an essentially unlimited nuclear fuel.
I'd first heard about thorium, molten salt reactors, and LIFTR in 2009.
I'm very excited to be here today at Google.
Having stumbled upon a series of Google Tech Talks.
If we have less to dispose of, that's a big advantage.
If there is any kind of major spill, et cetera, it just solidifies.
We come to give this information out freely, the use of thorium as an energy source.
It was really hard to believe that any viable source of energy could remain untapped for so long.
I'm offering you to drill on one of the great undeveloped fields of Little Boston.
Those areas have been drilled.
No, they haven't.
My straw reaches across the room.
We're pretty inventive when it comes to harvesting energy.
I drink your milkshake. I drink it up!
We're willing to take some pretty big risks. Are we overlooking the obvious?
This looks like an eye, doesn't it? Lord of the Rings, you know, the great eye is looking. It's really not an eye. This is uranium oxide, and when you put it in a reactor for a while, the solid fuel will begin to swell and crack, and you begin to get this central void. This is actually a gap in the fuel. And there's a single pellet. See how small it is? Back in the day, their business model for how to make a nuclear reactor was sometimes referred to as a razor blades business model. In other words, sell these reactors to utilities pretty much at cost in order to lock them in to a long-term fuel supply contract. We make this solid uranium oxide fuel, and there's a single pellet, and then we put them in these big reactor fuel elements, zirconium tubes that are like 12 feet long and about this big around. This is what they have to do about every 18 months. They'll take out about a third of the fuel, and then they'll load in about a third new fresh fuel, and then they'll reshuffle the fuel that's already been in there. They'll move it kind of from the center out to the periphery. It's kind of like when you went camping and you built a fire. The stuff on the edge isn't getting burned very good. LIFTR didn't like solid fuel. He was a chemical engineer by training, And he thought, what process do we run chemically based on solids? We don't. Everything we do, we use as liquids or gases because we can mix them completely. You can take a liquid, you can fully mix it. You can take a gas, you can fully mix it. You can't take a solid and fully mix it unless you turn it into a liquid or a gas.
And they began investigating some very, very radical nuclear reactors, totally different than the kind of stuff we have now, based on the idea that you could take salts and that they would be a really good medium in which to have a nuclear reaction.
Salt is formed from a positive ion and a negative ion. Like you take sodium and it loses its electron to chlorine, for instance. Chlorine says, give me that electron. Now chlorine's got an extra electron and sodium's missing one. So sodium's positively charged and chlorine's negatively charged. And they go, hey, let's kind of hang out with each other. And that's what's called an ionic bond. Some people say, well, that's not really a bond. It's like, yeah, you're kind of friends.
Facebook friends.
Facebook friends. All right, well, it turns out this is a really good thing for a reactor because a reactor is going to take those guys and just smack them all over the place with gammas and neutrons and everything. And the good news is they don't really care who they particularly are next to. As long as there's an equal number of positive ions and negative ions, the big picture is happy. So it turns out salts are a pretty dang good idea for a medium inside a reactor. And this was Wigner's idea. He said, okay, you know, regular matter's just going to get the snot kicked out of it. Put in salts. This is one of the coolest things about liquid reactor technology. We need to be able to separate the uranium from the thorium that's there. And hexafluorides are gases and tetrafluorides are in solution. Thorium only has a tetrafluoride, so you can sit there and pound it with fluorine all you want. It's not going to come out of solution.
But uranium has the ability to go from one valence state, uranium tetrafluoride, to uranium hexafluoride, which is a gas. So it will just come out like bubbles from a cola drink. This will extract uranium and not thorium. And the thorium's main job is to become new fuel.
Wigner was not successful in convincing the bulk of the nuclear community to take the thorium approach. Thorium, we haven't really messed with thorium, you know? It would be like starting over. But he did make one convert, this guy, Alvin Weinberg. He was his student during the Manhattan Project. Weinberg got a job offer to be the director of Oak Ridge National Labs in 1955. He was 35 years old. Until then, I had never quite appreciated the full significance of the breeder, the thorium reactor. But now I became obsessed with the idea that humanity's whole future depended on the breeder. And Weinberg got it. He got the big picture. He got, we need thorium, we need liquid fuel. I see it. I see what we got to do.
You know, this has got to be something we play very close to the vest. But I am being ruthless on one thing. Any activities that we possibly can should be placed in Southern California. You know, we need the jobs. Every time you have a chance, needle them. Say, where's this going to be? Let's push the California thing.
Well,
you do that.
Richard Nixon doomed thorium as an energy resource when he determined which reactor design would get funding based on where the accompanying jobs would be created.
All of this business about breeder reactors and nuclear energy and the stuff is over my head. That was one of my poorest subjects, science, and I got through it, but I had to work too hard. I gave it up when I was about a sophomore.
1979. Steve Jobs visits Xerox PARC and sees something both revolutionary and completely obvious.
He demanded that his entire programming team get a demo, and I said, no way. They were about to give away the kitchen sink.
Xerox could have owned the entire computer industry today. Could have been the Microsoft of the 90s.
I said I would only do it if I were ordered to do it, and that's what they did.
I thought it was the best thing I'd ever seen in my life.
Every icon has its own window, displaying the contents of a document. The screen approximates the appearance of a printed page.
Within 10 minutes, it was obvious to me that all computers would work like this. Basically, they were copier heads that just had no clue about a computer or what it could do. And so they grabbed defeat from the greatest victory in the computer industry.
Why nuclear energy? Especially after what happened in Japan. And why molten salt reactor? And why thorium?
The Chinese official, his name was Dr. Zhang Minghen, went to Oak Ridge. You know, they took him around the lab and showed him everything. And I'm told by my buddy who was there that they said, we're actually here to learn about the molten salt reactor. See, we're going to build one. We've already got a site picked out. We're here to learn everything we can about it. And the Oak Ridge people were like, huh.
China definitely needs clean energy. Absolutely. And thorium will provide them clean energy for hundreds of thousands of years. But frankly, I'd really like us to be able to do it too. And I'd like it to be something maybe that we developed rather than that we go buy.
I mean, we were working on this stuff a long time ago. We made great progress on it.
Kirk Sorensen had hoped someone else would take the concepts investigated at Ornell's molten salt reactor experiment.
Okay, Gordon, there you go, nail it.
And see them through to commercialization.
But you gotta remember, I did not see me doing it at all. Yeah. You know, I looked at it as like, wow, what a cool thing. But it wasn't, to quote our good friend Austin, it wasn't my bag, baby. All of these things had to be flexible. They had to be able to accommodate changes in geometry because they were moving around during blastoff to steer the rocket. I was an aerospace engineer. I had other things I needed to go do. This was something for nuclear engineers to go do. Oak Ridge would pick up the ball and go and, you know, restart the molten salt reactor. I was so naive.
He was beginning to spend more and more and more time mostly educating.
This is laws of physics stuff. I didn't invent it. All I do is promote it.
He got a phone call from a stranger and spent probably 45 minutes on the phone really being patient with the specifics and tapping my watch.
Maybe I'll never see it happen in my life, but somebody will do it. And once people have learned how to do it, they'll keep using it because it will make that much difference.
The 2009 Google Tech Talk proponents of thorium and molten salt reactors aren't just evangelizing anymore.
One of the keys is your neutron economy.
They're attempting to commercialize molten salt reactor technology, not just in the United States.
Dr. David LeBlanc, based in Ottawa, Canada, working hard to make that come true.
To see who will have the first operating molten salt reactor since 1969.
The bug was put in my ear to think about a new company.
Are you serious?
I mean, that just sounds crazy. And he says, I don't see any other way to do it.